We have discussions around future of universities. There was a session on RISE. That's the theme of the conference: resilience, innovation, sustainability, enterprise. We discussed skilling in higher education. So technology was something that was coming through in all the sessions that we've had. But even then, it was decided there has to be a focused, dedicated session around technology where we not just talk about the basic technological skills, which again has become very imperative and indispensable in the crisis that we all are in. Because FICCI also had started off a very exciting initiative called FICCI FutureX, which was more to do with the new age technologies that needs to be oriented towards for faculty and other people. But when this pandemic happened, we were advised by ministry and school regulatory board, boards like CBSE, that why didn't you get into a space where you give them a basic handholding of technology, because there's so much of virtual classrooms and all of that that is required of, because 5% of institutions may have that wherewithal, bandwidth and understanding, as opposed to the 95% which perhaps may not have. Then we relooked into the entire thing and got into this FICCI FDP program and kept FICCI FutureX on hold for a while. But now we find that last 7-8 months, whatever FDPs we've done, there were teachers who kind of taken it up very seriously, and institutions from August onwards find their faculty fairly comfortable. And of course, there's so much more to cover yet, but there is some amount of orientation and practice that faculty members from not so good technical, not so elite institutions have now got into as far as incorporating or integrating technology in the day-to-day teaching learning is concerned. So with that as a background, I would now want to introduce the moderator of the session, Mr. Ravi Panchanandan, who would kind of take the session on. And before I do that, I'll quickly briefly talk about his bio and experience that he's had in the space. So he's been managing all business units and enabling functions at Manipal Global Education. His previous role with Infosys BPO in India, where he was the SBU head for the manufacturing and ECS business verticals prior to Infosys. Apart from working on putting on India on the Intel supplier sourcing map, he was responsible for high value strategic contracts for Intel. And before that, he was with Hindustan Unilever Limited for close to 13 years. He's a bachelor's of electrical engineering from Jadavpur University, Kolkata, and holds a postgraduate diploma in management from XLRI, Jamshedpur. I would now request Ravi to take on with the session, please. Ravi, over to you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Rajesh. A very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome to this panel discussion. It's indeed a privilege to be moderating this session. A very warm welcome to all the panelists. And my first task is to introduce the, and a privileged task, if I may add, is to introduce the session chair, Mr. Jayesh Ranjan. Mr. Jayesh is a principal secretary of Industries and Commerce and Information Technology Departments of the Telangana government. He is a member of the IAS, Indian Administrative Service, of the 1992 batch. His assignment with the government of Telangana involves developing policy frameworks, attracting new investments, identifying opportunities for utilizing IT in various government processes, and promoting the digital empowerment of the citizens. He was awarded the World Bank's Social Capital Visiting Scholarship in 2002 and the British government's Gurukul Chevening Scholarship in 2005. He's on international consulting assignments for the World Bank, the UN HSCAP, the Siddharthu Project of Mexico, and for international NGOs working for youth issues like YES Incorporated of the USA and NMC from Italy. Sir, it's indeed a privilege to have you as part of the panel. And I welcome you, and I'll come back to you in a bit and ask you for the panel. Okay, this is it, yeah. Please give me a shout if you can see my screen. Okay. Please also join me in welcoming Dr. Ajit Chaturvedi, the director of IIT Roorkee. Dr. Chaturvedi received his BTech, MTech, and PhD degrees in electrical engineering from Indian Institute of Technology, Kanpur. He has served in the Department of Electronics Engineering in IIT BHU, Varanasi, and subsequently joined the faculty of Department of Electronics and Computer Engineering at IIT Roorkee. Professor Chaturvedi was a coordinator of the BSNL IIT Kanpur Telecom Center of Excellence, which has done a large number of projects for the Indian telecom sector. He's currently the director of IIT Roorkee. He is recipient of the INSA Teachers Award, the Distinguished Teacher Award of IIT Kanpur, and the Tan Chin Tuan Fellowship of NTU Singapore. Welcome, sir. Welcome, sir, to the panel. Let me now introduce Manish Sharma. Manish is the India head for GitHub. He has over two decades of professional journey of conceptualizing, building, marketing, selling, and supporting technology products. Manish enjoys working on strategic as well as operational roles, especially around new product development. He's currently the India head for GitHub, like I said. Previously, he has held several leadership roles in Adobe, VizIQ, SAP, and in his VizIQ role, he has been involved with Swayam, and we all know Swayam was a Government of India portal for education. He earned his master's in business administration from IIM Bangalore. I also extend a warm welcome to Krishna Kumar, who is the CEO of Simply Learn. Krishna founded simplylearn.com in 2010. And in the following years, he has built the company into one of the largest players in delivering certification, training for working professionals, and continuing education. A thought leader in the edutech space, Krishna believes in balancing technology with human interaction to deliver the world-class learning experience. I also extend a warm welcome to Mr. Lokesh Mehra, head of South Asia, the AWS Academy, the Amazon. Mr. Mehra heads AWS Academy for South Asia, which entails managing strategic relationships with MHRD, institutional bodies, policy-led engagements, and skill development initiatives, along with aligning universities with Amazon curriculum and specifications. He's worked earlier in the education and skills space at NASSCOM, Oracle, Symantec, Microsoft, Cisco, Intel, and NIT. So welcome, everybody. I think this promises to be a great discussion, a great panel. And I will kind of quickly set the context in the next two or three minutes before I invite the session chair to come and address the panel. So what I really wanted to kind of talk about was, who's the learner of the future? Because end of the day, all of this is being done, whether it's the technology or the university or Industry 4.0, we have the learner in mind. And somewhere down the line, it is important for us to understand what the learner is. So the way I've tried to define the learner is, if you really look at the top box, the gray box, I'm saying the learner is moving, used to be having a scarcity mindset. Now, what do I mean by scarcity mindset is he needed to compete and accumulate. So that was what scarcity mindset is all about. And he was salary focused, he was knowledge oriented. And today he has moved to what I call as the abundance mindset, which is more wealth oriented. He idealizes entrepreneurs. It is also competency oriented. So salary focused to a wealth orientation, knowledge oriented to competency orientation. So that is where his mindset, that's how his mindset is changing or has already changed. If you look at the bottom part, striving and grateful versus deserving, leading to deserving and expected. When I say striving and grateful, what I mean is he's prepared to make great efforts to get something. So think of him as a local. He wants to be local first before he steps into global. Think of him as, for him, the college education is most important. For him, education always used to be a long-term investment. Now, while all these still in part or in full remain, the way he has transformed himself into a deserving and expectant, he doesn't have to prove himself. So think of somebody like a Virat Kohli, right? Doesn't have to prove himself, young, raring to go. And he sees he has global expectations. He has he expects education and amenities of a certain level. He is not happy with just a teaching or a teacher teaching him. He has higher education aspirations. He wants bigger play. And also, he doesn't look at education as only investment. He says, if I've invested, what is the return of investment in my education? Last but not the least, which is what we are here to talk about, is, and he used to be digitally adjusted. What I mean is, he was always able to navigate the online resources, right? Now, he has today, if you look at the current crop of people coming in, they're all digitally native. Now, think of a five-year-old playing with an iPad. Think of people coding at school levels, at class six and class seven levels. So he has grown up, or he has been born into a world of apps and the world of computers. So from a classroom and faculty critical orientation, he moves to a self-study, shorter attention spans, rapid shift kind of a mindset. From a solo performer focusing on self, he moves to a collaborative kind of an environment. He loves working in teams, and therefore he becomes more digitally native than digitally expected. And if one were to do all of this, this has clearly disrupted the value chain for the learner. And while I will not go through the rest of the slide in detail, and we will start focusing on the academics and the assessment piece, but all the other value chain has been impacted, has been touched by digital. And while all this was happening, one must remember that these are the two accelerators that I keep referring to. The first accelerator actually started 2018-2019, when the government of India started formulating and taking inputs for the new education policy, and which finally got rolled out sometime in 2020, and we call it the NEP 2020. Now, this is a great positive accelerator, because what it does, it kind of sets certain boundaries, policy frameworks, it kind of introduces or adopts promises to adopt or encourages the adoption of new technologies, whether it's AI, ML, blockchain, adaptive computing, all of that, IoT, all of that put together. The second one, which is not such a positive thing to talk about, but it's still an accelerator, is COVID-19. And what COVID-19 has done is, while NEP 2020, we would have still been deliberating upon it, we would have still been planning how to implement it, COVID-19 made sure that all of us got kind of fast-tracked, and we got a velocity to adopt technology faster than what we would have done so. So therefore, both these accelerators, NEP 2020 and COVID-19, has to be kept in mind when we talk about evolving the evolution of the digital delivery model. And this is my last slide. If you read from left to right, the university of the future, or the digital university of the future, if I may call it that, will have four towers: the digital infrastructure tower, the digitized content and curriculum tower, the digi savvy faculty tower, and the proctored assessment tower. So these are the four, I'm sure there are others too, but these are the four critical towers which kind of will impact the adoption and the conversion of the transformation of the university to a digital university of the future. And if you see the extreme right, the outcomes would be employability, continuing education, and research. Now, how do we bridge the towers, and how do we bridge the outcome? And I call it the six vectors, because whatever we do in the four towers has to pass through the filters of accessibility, affordability, acceptability, learnability, teachability, and integrability. And with these six vectors, and if you were to overlay the overarching quality in everything that we do, because quality in everything that we do is, of course, table stakes these days. And if one were to superimpose the vectors on the quality, and you know what I'm talking about when it comes to digital infrastructure, content, faculty, and the assessment part. So this is where, this is how I would like to set the context. And may I now request Mr. Jayesh Ranjan to share his experience, his vision for Telangana, and how he sees the Industry 4.0 being assisted by the digital campus of the future. Mr. Ranjan.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Ravi, for introducing me. Let me first of all thank Fiki for putting together this very useful and a very timely conference. And greetings also to fellow panelists, all the attendees. I would like to, in the very beginning, mention about the fact that India is at a very important moment in its history. We have been poised to become a $5 trillion economy. National programs like Make in India, and now the next version of it, which is called Atmanirbhar Bharat, all of these are very, very strategically important programs. COVID has, of course, pulled us back to some extent. But nevertheless, while the world is now looking at a post-COVID economic recovery, we also anticipate that our country will make rapid progress. But we are also we all actually need to be also very conscious of the fact that similar ambitious programs, similar grandiose visions and plans have been announced in the past also. And if you look at the ground reality, our accomplishments, our achievements are far, far from optimal. And if you really do a deep dive of what is it that Make in India or National Atmanirbhar India or India going to become a $5 trillion economy, what is it that really prevents us from fulfilling these ambitions, fulfilling these aspirations? And in my mind, a large part of that will actually go to the doors of higher education systems. And I'm not talking about the best institutions that we have in the country, like the IIMs and the IITs and the Indian Institute of Sciences. I'm talking about the average university in India. And let me share this with you. I'm also the officiating vice chancellor of a university for more than a year and a half. There's a technology university in Hyderabad, which is called the Jawaharlal Nehru Technology University. And I've been its vice chancellor for the last, as I said, 18 months or so. And there are 240 colleges affiliated to this university. While some of them are very, very good, we feel very proud of their achievements. But if I look at the last college in my list and look at the kind of teaching learning which goes on there, look at the students there, look at the faculty there, look at the infrastructure there, then I do feel that when we say that our higher education systems are failing to deliver, and therefore all these $5 trillion economy, Make in India, Atmanirbhar India, these will remain pipe dreams. So I'm not really far off the mark. So, and even in good institutions, let me share something. I may be held kind of accountable for what I'm saying, but I can share this with full confidence. I've been to a very premier business school. And of course, I chose to get into the civil services, but many of my colleagues, many of my classmates in that school, even they tell us now and even earlier that they learned more outside the campus rather than being in the campus. So if in the best business school, if these kind of comments can be heard, that the moment I got into a job, I started learning more rather than the 2 years that I spent in college in the campus, then that also shows that there are many gaps between what we intend to deliver and what is actually delivered. And I completely agree with Mr. Ravi when he spoke about two good accelerators, two very timely accelerators. So if you look at which are, of course, the new education policy and the COVID imperative, where home-based education had to be done, had to be carried out over the last many months. And since we have found that to be of use and of value to the entire educational system, some form of it definitely will continue. And that is what we are all talking about, blended forms of learning. But if you look at really the gaps in the higher education system, I, in my opinion, see five, six kinds of gaps and deficiencies, which starts right from the way we select our teachers, the way, so I told you that I look after a university, and some of the colleges that I have are extremely remote, very rural, and it is impossible that highly talented and highly motivated faculty will actually decide to go and join that kind of a college. So the college right on day one will start with this handicap that only a very average kind of faculty will have to go and teach those students there. So how does digital or how does technology help in overcoming that handicap? And it is very obvious that it does, because now, since you are delivering lessons online, the teacher need not be in campus. The teacher can be sitting maybe thousands of miles away. And if you are able to access him and motivate him to conduct online classes, that is one opportunity. Obviously, there are lessons which are already posted online. There are a large number of, in our own education system, we have the Swayam platform through which you can access so many courses. And then there are providers like Coursera, etc., who also have brilliant lectures and classes which are available on demand. The other deficiencies in the education system is how do you create an immersive kind of a teaching learning experience? It is complained that most of our teaching learning processes are extremely exam oriented. I mean, you encourage the children, the students rather, to eventually go and end up writing an exam and get some good scores in that exam. Are they really learning? Are they valuing what they are learning? is extremely secondary. It is left to the choice of that student. So again, how does digital help in that? And we have seen in the last five, six months also, very interesting educational material have been developed, particularly for school children. But I'm sure it is possible to do it for college students, students of higher education as well, to design curriculum, online curriculum, which brings in lots of experiential kind of learning, the way it has been done for school children. And the new education policy also asks us to go away from this exam system and have a system of continuous evaluation, which is also demonstrated, not just by writing an exam, or but by doing multiple assignments during your curriculum time, and also doing practical work, and so on and so forth. The third very important issue is about employability. And here also the new education policy speaks about it, that how do you filter students, or how do you do a kind of a assessment of students, whether they're good for vocational stream or a research stream or an academic stream. So again, digital opportunities are there of getting students evaluated, tested, and so on and so forth. This, the fourth point, which I already alluded to, is about the involvement of industries and corporates in providing practical experience, practical learning experience to the student. So when the best business school students tell that I learned more in my job rather than in the college, it reconfirms the belief that lots of practical learning can be introduced during the curriculum period itself. And new education policy also speaks about it. So how do you ensure the students engage with industries, get a sense of the real world out there as a part of their education process as well? And the last thing is about entrepreneurship, because not every bit of education is eventually going to lead to jobs. We know this, and we are seeing this happen in our country also quite a lot, that there are many students who are opting out of placements, who want to become entrepreneurs, who want to start their own enterprises, who are having some great ideas. So how can we provide support to such students who have this seed of becoming an entrepreneur in them in the student stage itself? How can we provide incubation support? How does one encourage them to convert their college project into something which is related to their entrepreneurial idea? How does technology help in that? So my personal feeling is that all the deficiencies which we have seen in our higher education teaching learning processes, and I am clarifying this again and again and again, I am the smallest college located in the most remote location of our country, and the students who teach study there, and the faculty who teaches there. I know that we have the director of IIT Roorkee. I'm not talking about IIT Roorkee at all. They are 20 leagues ahead of this, these kind of colleges. So we, if we are serious about improving the country as a whole and looking at our demographic dividend and how everyone contributes into this $5 trillion economy goal and Atmanirbhar goals, etc. It is not the IITs alone who are going to do that. Heavy lifting has to be done by the last college in the remotest corner, as I said. And unless we re-look at what those challenges have been all these years, all these decades, and in what ways can technology or digital education help us come out of those deficiencies, we will be missing the bus yet again. So these are some of my opening thoughts. I'm very keen to listen to experts from the field of education and academic and industry, and benefit from their views also. Finally, one or a couple of sentences about Telangana. Telangana is a new state, as all of us know, but we have done pretty well in the last 6 years in terms of setting very progressive and extremely benchmarked policies. We are the national role model in many ways, the way we impart skills and knowledge to our students. We have an institution called TASK, the Telangana Academy for Skills and Knowledge, which has become a national role model in many ways. So we'll be very keen if people are willing to collaborate with us in deepening digital education and ensuring that benefit reaches, as I said, always to the last student in the remotest college. We'll be very happy to work together. So as I said, look forward to listening to other panelists, and thank you very much for giving me this chance.
Thank you, Mr. Ranjan. I think that was really, what you talked about, immersive teaching experience, really connected. And we'll come back to you and after the panelists, so that we can get some more best practice sharing from Telangana, because like you rightly said, Telangana has been a benchmark state which is a short way as far as IT and information technology is concerned. Can I now call upon Dr. Ajit Chaturvedi? Sir, I mean, in line with what Mr. Ranjan talked about, the faculty readiness for digital delivery of content as one of the things. And then we could also talk about the contribution of online teaching and how that could be integrated into the main digitized content and curriculum. And I know that you are very passionate about proctored assessments and evaluations. So if you can, in 4 to 5 minutes of what you want to say, if you can cover these broad topics, I think that could be very useful. Dr. Chaturvedi.
Yeah, thank you to Fikki for organizing this useful and important session. Get a chance to discuss these important things, as pointed out by my previous co-panelist, that if we have to realize the dream of the future of India, these things are very, very important, very enabling requirements. In this context, given the accelerator COVID-19, as correctly pointed out by Ravi, I think we have to step back a little bit and look at the last century or a century and a half and recall as to what was the principal support that teachers were using in the last century and a half. And that principal support was in the form of textbooks. And these textbooks used to be the very important resource material for both teachers as well as the students. Although students also have access to the textbooks, but there was a need that the textbook is taught in the class so that its meaning and implication and import can be translated to the student who is learning the subject for the first time. Now, in this online world, digital world, as we know that more and more digital technologies are required to be able to do effective online teaching, so that every college, it should be real socialism should come, so that whether it's an IIT or whether it is the last mile college, any college, the access to quality education is now feasible because of the availability of digital technologies. And so it is the right time to seize this opportunity and create a parallel of the book industry. Unless we create digital content which uses augmented reality, virtual reality, artificial intelligence, data science, all these modern technologies, they have to come in, and a whole new industry vertical can be created whose job will be only to replace the textbook. If we are not replacing the teacher, and we are not saying that students will be able to learn everything on their own, we are only saying that for the teachers to be effective, it is very unlikely, or it is not possible, that every teacher can create his or her own digital content, which can be effective in the same manner as done by a professional who is only specializing in that domain. Please remember that even in the case of book writing, the authors were not writing the books on their own. They needed the printing industry, they needed the composition, they needed typesetting, somebody needed to draw the figures, draftsman, a whole lot of support system was required for any author to be able to write a book. Same kind of support system is required at this time to be able to create effective digital content, which can make education accessible to across the spectrum. And at the same time, it will not be requiring that every teacher becomes as digitally savvy as required as of today. Today, it is very difficult on many teachers, because while they are able to pick up effective mechanisms to teach, but they do not have the content. They do not have the relevant way of conveying, for example, experimental ideas, physical ideas, and then they create some videos of their own, and there can be very amateurish efforts, which are indeed required, but that alone will not help. Second thing I want to say is that I think it will be good to understand what is the role of educational institutions, whether IITs or whether the last mile college. It is not at all to replicate the real world experience that you get in the industry. And so that expectation that a student who comes out of a business school, or who comes out from an IIT, or who comes out from an NIT or any college, should know everything that is done in the industry in the short term, I think we need to revisit that expectation, because that will defeat the purpose of education. The purpose of education is to make the student give the student the ability to learn for the next 40, 50 years. And that is what our curriculum is designed at, that how to spark the curiosity, how to spark the desire to learn, how to orient the thinking in the engineering profession or in the business profession or in the humanities profession. It is not at all to replace the need for learning. I think if the students are learning when they enter the industry, that's very good. That's a good sign that they have picked up this ability to learn, and that effective teaching was possible. That does not mean that we should teach outdated material. We should teach relevant material, but we should deliberately avoid teaching things which are relevant only in the short run. Because if you teach too many things only in the short run, the student gets obsolete. He or she does not develop the ability to think. And as I said, the product, that is the student, has to be relevant for the next 4 or 5 decades. Last point I would quickly make, I know I'm running short of time, is that about proctored assessment. I think if we do not address this problem very quickly, there is a real danger that the credibility that online education and teaching has acquired in the recent past, that credibility will evaporate. Because COVID-19 pushed it, we took it very seriously, teachers, students, everybody. And this is the time to make sure that the grading and the assessment and the marking scheme can carry the credibility that was there in the pre-COVID era. And real students are really struggling because of infrastructure requirements. Some proctored schemes need the video to be on. They are high bandwidth applications. Students struggle in doing that. So we are managing for 1 or 2 or maybe 3 semesters, something can be done. But if this technologically, this is not addressed in an adequate manner, I think it will hurt the enabling feature of digital education. I would stop here, and again, thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Aljeet. I think, how to spark desire to learn. I think that's a good point that you made. I think maybe that's a good segue. So if indeed the universities and the institutes are mandated to spark the desire to learn, and how to question the status quo, if that is the role. Mr. Lokesh, how do you see, what is the role of digital infrastructure? What is the role of micro-credentialing? What is the role of the digital savvy faculty? How do you see these three things play out if indeed an institute has to become, to spark the desire to learn?
So thank you, Ravi, and good afternoon, everybody. I'll just quickly give a context prior to answering your question. Look, business as usual today has become quite challenging. But digital solutions, as JSG said, they are often seen more as an afterthought rather than something that is, woven into the university's DNA. But there's no one size that fits all. Universities were created specifically to be highly decentralized, to encourage creative thinking, autonomy with different departments. However, the decision making is still, I would say centralized, and digital practices are something which are individual department run. So they sit on the outskirts rather than, I would say, on the practice of inside out. So if I look at universities today post COVID, I would bucket them into 4 R's. The universities which have been reactive, who have responded to the COVID and tried to do something, oh shucks, COVID has come, let me do something. The second R is in terms of resilience, where these universities have managed through the uncertainty. The third is in terms of recovery. Now, how do I capitalize on that opportunity and move forward? And the fourth is the reality that now this is the new normal. So the universities need to step up that pace of transformation, and action is required specifically to advance their digital competitiveness, which would be investment in people, processes, and say technologies. So coming specifically to the question, Ravi, that you said and what JSG and Doctor had mentioned, from an infra side, if you look at it, majority of the institutions have realized the value of putting information online. So during admission time or during exam time, the servers get pinged a lot. So how do I look at dynamic scaling that, it would not impact and my total cost of ownership gets reduced? Second thing is in terms of storing information. I think a lot of the universities in the past 6 to 8 months have created so much content. Some have been very rudimentary in terms of plugging, you know, normal digital books, creating books just out of whatever has been made available. But then there are others who have created good videos. Now, can you store this on the systems? Can you have this available over the cloud? And can you also look at leveraging this? For example, from an infra side, I would recommend most of the universities to look at a text to speech. So if I've created those videos, can I transcribe that? Can I plug it in different languages? Can I, you know, plug it out there? Even from a research side, what we realized is that most of the universities, the research was suspended. But if it was made available, you know, on the databases which were there, then it would be easily accessible. So that digital infrastructure was missing out there. And as you know, Amazon, what we have been doing is we have been providing cloud grants and credits to the universities who are looking for specific opportunities. Now, to pursue the learning, I think it is very imperative for us to look beyond the boundaries of an academic calendar or a terminal evaluation. And how can that be? I think, you know, both Dr. and Dr. Jayesh Ranjan talked about the learner at the center. So you need to have personalized learning. You could look at flipped classrooms. You could look at distance learning. You can learn at your own pace. But to do that, you would require an infrastructure for better learning outcomes, which would include LMS, a student lifecycle management, or automated assessments. To just to segue to the assessments, I think Ravi, proctored assessments are very critical, because the more regular micro testing that you are going to do, it's going to give, you know, granular insights to the faculty. And the advantage that you have in terms of, you know, avoiding plagiarism, verifying the identity of candidates and ensuring the security, which lets me to segue into security. In fact, there was a recent study carried out by Barracuda, which indicated that 10,000 institutions were attacked within the time frame from June to September, just, you know, last year. And most of these people didn't realize, our faculty, unfortunately, especially in the remote areas, do not even update their virus or, you know, the space base updates which are there in the operating system. And they were phished in terms of, you know, getting a mail from their principal or director, which was a phishing or a spamming mail, which had a URL of the vice chancellor, you know, the virtual conferences. They just saw that it's a mail from the head of the institution and they clicked on it. And the hacker was able to get these people to register, get their names, email IDs, and their contact details. So risk management needs to be a very big priority. Overnight, what has happened in COVID, the faculty specifically have been expected to become IT experts. But I think what JSG also talked of, how do you make it immersive? How do you make it more engaging? So that's where the use of AI and ML becomes very, very critical. For example, you could look at adaptive assessments. Or say if I'm a mechanical engineer and I'm teaching engines, a hybrid engine. Earlier, what used to happen is in the lab, you'll have 10 people working on the engine and then 20 people standing behind. But now with AI VR, it is easily possible with AR VR to, you know, have all of them working on it. Even gamified learning, in fact, a lot of the our partners currently, the EdTech organizations, they've been specifically working on content which can be gamified in the nature. And basic concepts like looking at RFID or, you know, IoT for your attendance, all these things from a digital infrastructure are very important. I'll just speak for 30 seconds on a specialized piece, because now employability has become very, very critical. So I beg to differ with Dr. Ajit when he said that, you know, the student, what he's learned should remain for multiple decades. I feel that we need specialized skills and we need to adjust to those labor market needs. So for instance, Task in Telangana has tied up with us where they're offering our Educate and Academy initiative. So in short, it implies shorter courses and stackable credentials. I think then it becomes very, very important for everybody to go ahead and adopt these courses. So I'll pause out here, Ravi, and back to you. I think I'm in time.
Thank you very much, Lokesh. I think you bang on time. Be clearly, I think you brought in a very good aspect of security, because with so many things going digital, how do we ensure that we kind of manage the digital risk? I think that's a very good point. And also the point about stackable credentials. I think that's something that we could talk about as we move forward. Can I ask Manish? Manish, can you talk to us about digital infrastructure, Industry 4.0, AI, IoT, AR, VR? I mean, how do these things become core of the operations, and how does this work?
Thank you, Ravi, and good afternoon, everybody at Wiki and the fellow panelists. I think I can. There's a broad topics that you've asked me, Ravi, but I think I'll try to summarize based on my experiences and a lot of my opinions, having been in the industry and working with the educational ecosystem for a long time. A lot of my views actually concur with what Dr. Chaturvedi talked about. If you look at digital infrastructure, it's been ready for a very long time. Yes, COVID has accelerated, you know, the adoption piece, but it has also pointed out a lot of inefficiencies in the system, especially the paradoxes that exist. You know, my wife is a teacher in a college, and she shares stories with me about families where, you know, they're not able to attend online classes because they have small homes, right? And also having to share infrastructure. They don't have multiple laptops or multiple phones. So I think this whole concept of digital infrastructure being available is great, but it has to come in the context of how all of this will get consumed by students at large. And especially in a country as large and diverse in India, I think we still need to evolve on how digital infrastructure and education will intersect. And more importantly, I love what Dr. Chaturvedi and Ms. Ranjan talked about, which is the faculty. So if you think about it, you know, platforms like Khan Academy, platforms like WebEx, Zoom, they have been around for many, many years. But the learner has been ready to accept these things. Like, we've had the students and learners going to these platforms and consuming. The faculty have not really come on board. Not that they didn't want to, but they were not enabled. You talked about us working on Swayam. When we used to go and talk to different universities, the biggest problem the chancellors and the directors used to share with us was, hey, my professor is not able to create the content to teach the student. So if I have to even do in-classroom digital teaching, the content is not ready for me to use. And so getting the faculty ready for this is very, very, very important. I think because in the educational ecosystem for forever, ever since, you know, human beings started learning, the trainer, teacher, faculty is always at the core. So even with digital infrastructure being available, the content going online, unless you have that helping hand of the faculty guiding students on, you know, what they should do, how they should do it, it's that problem of abundance, Mr. Ravi, that you showed in your first slide. There is abundance, there is digital awareness among students, but they need to be guided through a path of what they need to do. And technology is an enabler of all of these things. It's going to come, and it has already started coming to the benefit of students and faculty alike. Like Lokesh talked about proctoring. I think proctoring is a great thing because if you think about what goes on in India, we have people moving around cities just to take examinations. Even to get trained on a competitive exam, they have to go and live in other cities. So now, because of the digital infrastructure that's available, it can come to them. I think that is what digital is really helping everybody achieve. I think on the last point, which you talked about Industry 4.0, I think this ecosystem is still evolving. We're all, at least, you know, me in the industry, we're all product of our education ecosystem, which has been there for a long time. And I'd like to believe it has worked well, but things are evolving on both sides. Industry's requirements are also changing. And since I'm in the technology code world, it's easier for the industry of digital/software to engage with institutions because the physical infrastructure is still there, right? Unlike, you know, let's say mechanical engineering or accounting and other things where you definitely do need different kind of infrastructures to come in. And probably as Lokesh was saying, the VR and AR related technologies to bring these concepts to students on digital will definitely help. But I think we are still evolving. COVID definitely has been an accelerator, but I think the minute it goes away, we will all go back to what normal used to be. But this experience has actually enabled everybody to understand the possibilities. Earlier, there was an hesitation of even looking at the possibilities. Now, when we go back to the normal, there will be the blended concepts that will come in, right? the faculty will be more attuned to, okay, what do I need to learn to keep pace with what the students are asking for? Industries have also figured out stuff like internships, right? So if I need to provide internships to remote location universities, like Mr. Ranjan was saying, the student doesn't have to travel to that location. Maybe we can do internships online. So I think these models are the stuff that really excite me about the possibilities in our country over the next few years. Thank you, and I will hand it back to you, Mr. Ravi.
Thank you, Manish. I think two things really struck me. One is, of course, your focus on the learner, and how do we ensure that the digital infrastructure is accessible to the learner? I think that's a good point, and we'll come back to that as we go along. The other thing that really struck was, how does one create content and have content ready? So which kind of, it's a nice segue to move into Krishna. Krishna, can you talk about how does one, you know, you have content, and how do you have online content at that? How do you integrate that with the formal education structure? So for example, let's say Dr. Ajit Chaturvedi wants to do a mechanical engineering or an electrical engineering class. And if you have content, how do you integrate that? And how does both of these two become one? That is number one. And Mr. Ranjan, as well as some of the other esteemed panelists, talked about the industry academia partnership for 4.0. How does this entire continuing education flow into the industry academia partnership, both not only for internships, but for employment and continuing education? And I think you're in a good space, since you focus on continuing education a lot, maybe it's a good idea for you to, if you can focus on that. You're on mute, Krishna, if you can.
Yes. So thank you, Ravi, and thank you, Fikki, for this opportunity. Within my stipulated time, Ravi, I'll just take some tangent topics and cover that quickly. So great to be a part of a panel where there are so many accomplished panelists. I want to start with the point that Mr. Ranjan made about Atmanirbhar Bharat. That's a topic that is very close to my heart. And one point that I wanted to add is that irrespective of whatever government does, irrespective of whatever our higher education institutions do, we will be a 5 trillion economy just because of the sheer aspiration of the young people of our country. And I wanted to give my example. I grew up in a village in Bihar, studied till 12th grade only in Hindi medium, completed engineering. And today I run one of the largest education companies in the country. SimpliLearn is a 500 crore annual business, growing at about 50% year on year, and the only profitable edtech company in the country. So I think it has just happened because of technology. I saw technology, I saw opportunity, I latched onto the opportunity, kept doing the basics, and it worked so well for us. So what do we do at SimpliLearn? Very simple. We talked a lot about content. In my view, if people could learn from content, then people could have learned from books. There was no need to invent universities, schools, and colleges. The reality is that if you look at a talent pyramid, only the top 10% talent can learn on their own. The remaining talent requires handholding, they require instruction, they require group to work together, they require somebody to show them direction. And that's exactly what we do on SimpliLearn platform. Learner come to our platform in spite of so many free options available in the market. You can get all kinds of best content on YouTube for free. Why do people come and pay thousands of dollars on SimpliLearn platform to learn? The only thing that they want is that they want to get taught by instructor. So some of the top instructors come on SimpliLearn platform and they train. We train people on new and emerging technology like data science, machine learning, cybersecurity, and so on. So not only you train them, we show them how to make use of those technologies. And that's what has helped us grow so well in the market. Now I want to give one more perspective about our higher education institution ability to attract talent. A typical trainer on a SimpliLearn platform, on an hourly basis, they get paid about $250 an hour. That's our average pay. Which university in India can afford this kind of pay? It's practically impossible. And at $250 and $300 an hour kind of pay also, it becomes extremely difficult for us to go and get an AIML expert or a cybersecurity expert or some other expert. But we do that. We have a global pool through which to do that. So what we have seen over the years is that if you want to teach skills to a majority of the talent, you have to provide them interactivity, engagement, and give them something that they can work on while we do. While our platform is primarily suitable for working professionals, that's where we started. And since it's a paid and a costly platform, most people who already have a job, they come on our platform to learn so that they can excel in their career. And we curate our programs with some of the top tech companies like Google, Microsoft, Amazon, to name some of the industry partners, and some of the universities like MIT, Caltech, Purdue to curate our program. Of lately, we have seen a lot of interest from universities coming and contacting us to embed our curriculum as part of their program. Again, we see them coming to us just to solve one problem. While they want to teach digital skills, where are the instructors? Even if a university wants to teach cybersecurity to their student, one option is give them content. But how many students can learn from the content? Our estimate is not even 5% of students can learn. If they are not part of IITs and top NITs, if you just give them the curriculum, not even 5% of students can learn on their own. If you have to make our students learn, we need to give them the right kind of instructions, right kind of handholding, a right kind of environment so that while they are learning, they can practice also. And that, with that kind of thought, we have suddenly started seeing a lot of universities coming and contacting us to embed our curriculum as part of their coursework. We don't have an on-the-ground team to go and talk to university, but still we work with a lot of universities. Like one of the university, I'll give you, Mr. Ranjan, which is very close to your state in Andhra, is called KL University, where thousands of students in KL have taken our curriculum, and we solved only one use case for them. KL being a very popular university, campus placement was not their challenge. The challenge was that most of the people are getting placed at 3 lakhs. They wanted to increase the placement from 3 lakhs to 5 lakhs. How do you do that? The only way for you to do is that teach them the skills that the industry requires. How do you teach them? We don't have faculty. You can't get faculty. As I'm being in the business for last 10 years, trying to get faculty from pretty much every part of the world, I can tell you that if you don't pay the kind of money that these people deserve, you can't get faculty. So only option is that embed my curriculum as part of a coursework. And these students can teach them from anywhere. So some of our instructors that teach KL students are sitting in Bay Area and teaching them AI and ML. So we see this model working very well for us. So Ravi, coming back to your point, I think when we talk about the digital infrastructure, the infrastructure is not only the infrastructure to make our content run on the platform. The infrastructure is also the hands-on environment where people try and learn those skills by actually practicing on it. And I will say the whole faculty is also kind of infrastructure, because we generally forget about their role. I think very, very important component if you want to impart real good digital education. I'll just stop there. I think
I think the point that you made about instructors being critical, and it's just not about digital content or digital infrastructure. There's also a need for somebody who can use the infrastructure, use the content, and reach out to the learner and make sure that he or she picks it up. And your 5% example, not more than 5% learn on their own, I think it's a fairly startling one, because one would have thought that India has much more than 5% who can learn on their own. But having that was a good session. Sir, Mr. Ranjan, can I come back to you? And because I think we would all like to hear from you. How does the state of Telangana plan to create universal access to digital infrastructure? Because all of us are saying the same thing, saying that, look, the learner has to have access to infrastructure. And somebody, and you very rightly said, sir, that the policy or the facility has to not just be made for a few, not for somebody only in Hyderabad, but also, let's say, in the remote parts of Andhra, Bihar, UP, they should be able to access online. They should be able to benefit from that. So how is Telangana planning to address this? And while you're answering that, sir, if you also tell us what are the best practices that the other states could, if we can pick a page out of the state of Telangana books, what would be those things that we should be looking at?
Yes, thank you. But first of all, let me mention this, that I found some great pieces of ideas and suggestions in other panelists' comments as well. And I thank all of them. But coming back to what you are asking. Now, digital infrastructure is at the backbone. If you want to deliver digital education, then digital infrastructure has to be in place. And many of you would know that a very ambitious national program is going on, which is called Digital India. And providing digital infrastructure is an important component of Digital India. But in Telangana, what we have done is that we have exceeded what the goals and targets of Digital India is. Digital India provides for linking the panchayats through optic fiber cable. But in Telangana, our goal is to provide dedicated optic fiber cable to every household. And regardless of where you are, you may be in some very remote village. Some of the villages could be in forest areas. Some could be on some hilltops and all. But our ambition is to bring optic fiber cable broadband to every home. And this is a humongous task. There are 8.5 million homes in the state. And earlier we were, of course, we were determined to do it, but our timelines were slightly longer. But in the COVID scenario, we have realized that the faster we do it, the more useful it will be for the people. So we have decided to complete this project within a year's time. So hopefully by the end of 2021, every home in Telangana will be wired. And obviously that opens up enormous possibilities. You can deliver not just education. See, in the times of COVID, healthcare, health-seeking behavior has also been compromised and diluted because people are aware about the infection risks, etc. And non-COVID ailments are also not getting their due attention. So e-health can be offered, teleconsultation can be offered, e-commerce, rural e-commerce, and so many government services which can be delivered online can be delivered now to people sitting at their homes. So this is one very important piece of digital infrastructure which we are fast-tracking in Telangana. But let us also be aware and conscious of one more reality, which is that even if you take a cable to the homes of people, there would still be hundreds and hundreds and thousands of people who will not be enamored by it. It is not that I went to sleep in the night and when I woke up, someone told me, hey, there is cable at your door, and they started buying a laptop and a desktop and a smartphone. Many people will not value what this broadband will do to them. And obviously some people will not be able to afford these kind of devices. So the other model which we are following in Telangana is what is called an assisted model. In every panchayat, we are setting up a digital kiosk. We call them digital Telangana centers. And the government will fund the entire infrastructure, including hardware. And we are selecting a woman entrepreneur in that village. And we see lots of social multiplier effect if a woman is there. And using that woman as the delivery intermediary, we are ensuring that in the off hours, people, students can come and look at YouTube lessons or other lessons which are there on the net, and so on and so forth. So these are some of the ways in which the government is supplementing digital infrastructure. Of course, the telecom operators have their own rollout plans for 4G, 5G, which also the government is facilitating and assisting. So very shortly, I don't want to name any particular operator here, but one of the operators which has a very large footprint in our country. It is a matter of a few months before they are going to declare Telangana as the first state where they have 100% 4G coverage. So multiple ways of supplementing and augmenting digital infrastructure. But as all of us agreed, I noticed this common thread in every panelist's views that it is like that saying of taking the horse to water, but you can't really force that horse to drink. So we can create this pool of water, but eventually, where does the motivation come from? And do you have students who are each self-motivated and have that desire to learn? And therefore, the role of instructors, the role of trained instructors, and their ability to distill the essence of that course in modules which are easily understandable, which they can relate to. I agree with Professor Chaturvedi that not everything leads to eventually what you are going to do in job. Knowledge is far more broad-based than just linked to a job. But how do you still make that relevant and contextual and easy to understand, given the fact that many students in these kind of colleges are sometimes first-generation learners, so there are not much of households or home support in their learning initiatives and so on and so forth. So technology does provide means to many of these challenges that we have faced. Glad to hear other panelists expressing unanimity that the technology can be that real big bullet which can help the country's achievement of its goals and ideas.
Thank you, Mr. Rajan. Dr. Ajit, if I may just quickly come across this, there's also an audience question, which I'm going to bundle it along with your question, with my question. So the question I really wanted to ask you was, where do you see the right balance between online, campus, proctored assessments, social networking requirements of the students? Because students still want to come back to campus, like what Krishna said, they need to be, they need to be an instructor, to form teams, integrate ecosystems. And when you're answering the question, sir, one of the questions that has come up from the audience is, how do you take care of heavy duty analytics work? or heavy lab requirements as part of your assessment. How do you bundle that into when IIT is doing assessments, or when you're doing that, how do you take care of these big ticket items?
Yeah, so one thing that is suffering in this digital online education is, and maybe people will adjust to it, is that collaborative learning is suffering. See, when you are in the campus, it is not only about the classroom teaching or the laboratory teaching, but more importantly or equally importantly, the collaborative teaching. So when you form teams, when you do projects together, when you do assignments together, when there is an assignment and nobody is able to solve, but when two students sit together, they are able to crack it. Now, that kind of replacement on the digital platform is yet to come. That effective, collaborative teamwork, project work, that kind of learning, it is just irreplaceable. It has nothing to do with the classroom teaching. It has nothing to do with the laboratory teaching. It is something that is a very important part of growing up of any professional education environment. Now, I hope that we'll find some ways to address that. Now, coming to your question regarding how we are doing the heavy duty analytical work or the mathematical work. See, one advantage that IITs have, or maybe I can also say one disadvantage, is that the number of students are not like in lakhs or tens of lakhs or things like that. So it is a very scalable model. So when you have 100 students or 200 students or 300 students to do the to teach, you can do a lot of things manually and you can expect the student to do it. For example, we can request the students, okay, write the exam in your hand if you are doing a heavy duty maths or very analytical equations, take a snap of it and upload it. Now everybody has a camera. I mean, at least most IIT students will have a camera in their phone. So they will be able to scan it and upload it. And just like physically, when we were checking or grading the exams, same kind of thing can continue. But this kind of thing is not scalable. I mean, if we want to take assessment and online assessment to thousands or lakhs or millions of students, we have to find better ways of doing it. Coming back to a right balance, I think the right balance is that some kind of education now, it's very clear that some percentage, maybe 20, 30, maybe 40% is definitely doable completely digital online, which does not need any classroom teaching, which does not need any laboratory work that can easily be done. This percentage will vary depending on the discipline and also depending on the engineering discipline, that how much can be accepted online. The remaining part can be done in a teamwork, or it can be done as a physical, because last 1 year at least we can see that laboratory work has suffered, hands-on training is suffering. The kind of skills that you develop by failing and learning when you work on real equipments or real laboratory work, that kind of thing is missing. We can think of virtual labs, we can think of augmented virtual reality, all those kinds of things, but we are still far away from that feel or the kick that you get when you see a real physical thing, first failing and then you do something and then it starts working. So that kind of replacement is still to come. So I would say that is still required to be done physically on campus till we get better solutions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ajit. I want a couple of more questions, and I'm also trying to interweave any questions from audiences that is coming on my chat. If I can request the panelists to be slightly brief, because we have just about 10 minutes to close the panel. So Manish, can I move quickly to you? How do you see EdTech playing? What is the role of EdTech in unlocking the value of education system? So how do you see that play out?
I think our entire panel, where we talked about digital being used for imparting education, I think EdTech sits at the center of it. Just like what internet has done from a distribution perspective, EdTech is doing that. What Mr. Krishna Kumar talked about, universities accessing faculty or somebody sitting in the Bay Area and teaching. I think platforms like these evolving to increase distribution of education content and also getting faculty access to students, I think we will definitely see an increase in that.
Thanks, Manish. Quick one, Krishna. I mean, I'm not going to let you go without answering this question, because tell us some of the best practices that you think we can follow for integrating online courses into formal. I still don't have an answer from you. because we have, I now realize we have two vice chancellors. You must tell us how we can make them integrate.
So thanks, Ravi. So I think I want to keep this answer short. So I first let me admit that I don't think I have the right answer, because we have not done this at a scale. This phenomena of universities working with providers like us is still very, very early. I think if you go and talk to the universities, though they realize that there is a gap, they need to do something about it, that acceptance is not as high as what we would have expected. So I don't think I have solved this problem, so I can give you a definite answer that yes, this works. But in some of the cases where I have seen what works is that it's a very collaborative approach. Like and collaborative approach wherein if some universities who are like deemed university, they have this flexibility of giving multiple options to students that you can do this also, but if you're interested, you can do that also. So letting students also choose that, okay, should I do this, my specialization in this credit or that credit, I think there we have seen a lot of acceptance. Like I'll talk about the scale example, wherein the body that decided on what course to buy was actually a student body. And I was very curious to know that we are not pitching to universities, how come these guys are coming in and buying in thousand. So what I realized that one of the students had an uncle working in a US-based company called Verizon, and he wanted to ask his uncle advice that my college is giving this option of taking another course from an outside provider. What course should I take and which place should I go? Actually, for us, that uncle was a student of Simply Learn, and he was sitting in somewhere in Florida, and that's how this whole engagement started. And it became a very, very scale engagement. In fact, we did about 7,000 students, and all of them completed the program within 4 or 5 months. I was trying to wonder what is working for them. What was working for them that they decided what they want to do and how they want to do. And that worked really very well. So I think I don't have the answer. I mean, maybe 2 years down the line, when you do this for multiple university, I can give you a definite answer.
Thanks, Krishna. Lokesh, I've got a question from the audience also. Which I'm going to integrate. I think they picked up what you said about security, right? And the question is there is a security issue as well as availability of sound digital platform for education purposes. And they feel that India is an IT, IT capital of the world, so to say. Why is it that there are still no Indian product available which can take this into account? And then I'll ask you my second question.
Sure. I don't think there are number of platforms which are already available. It's just that you need to put endpoint security at, these respective platforms, which majority of the large edtech providers, including Krishna and say Byju's or, all our partners who are edtech partners, they do follow that principle. What happens at an institution level is that always what I stated initially, that IT sits at the outskirts of the university. It's not woven into the DNA. So when this person goes and says, sir, that we have got this platform, now please give me money to, secure this platform, the head honcho may just, say, let's take it in the next budget, not now. And that gets shipped, postponed to a later date. So it is imperative to look at an end-to-end solution. It is very, very critical to, prevent anything from a security angle, because security is so critical. Look at PII now with GDPR coming in the US. It is very important, that we should be adopting where our information is not shared with everyone, on a free flow basis. Unfortunately, I can get, Aadhaar numbers or anywhere across the net. So I think it is critical for the universities to realize, and I had said, risk management is a priority. Look, technology is not a panacea. It's not a magic wand that I'll do. It is technologies, what people can do with it.
Yeah. Now, and I think there's a follow-up question, Lokesh, which I've been wanting to ask you, and then maybe you can quickly go around the table and then we can wrap. What is the effect of the digital transformation that we're talking about? How do you see it play out on mental health, wellness? Because people are sitting at home doing online classes. So what's your take? And maybe after this, Mr. Ranjan, if you could also address this issue of, mental health and well-being in the process of digital transformation, how does one see that play out?
So very apt question, Ravi. In fact, what I've seen is mental health has, kind of got enlarged due to multiple things. Number one is isolation. Number two is this remote education piece where Dr. Ajit also said you're not collaborating. Number three is the frustration that happens. Your net falls down, you can't hear the other person, something or the other. Third is the stress which goes with it. Look at all of us who are in the industry. Half the time we are worried, I hope the net does not fall off when I'm doing a very important call. And that anxiety which goes along with it. as a university, what can you do? And you can also look at, you know, how do you offer non-academic co-curricular activities which would, you know, involve these students? Number two, from a tech perspective, can you look at predictive analysis, which would trigger support, you know, or it is pushed that you push that info as soon as you can capture it from social media to a contact center. So this individual or the student can then reach out to the contact center and possibly talk to them and get that, you know, help or conflict resolution, whatever is possible. So I think it is very critical to, you know, at least manage mental health in current scenario, whatever we have.
Mr. Ranjan, what would you comment?
I completely agree that it is quite stressful for students. In any case, they are handling hundreds of other stressful things, and the challenges of mastering digital technologies adds to their worry. So obviously, we need to think of it. We have not really figured it out that it could have been, that it could become such a serious issue. But now that we have so many months of experience behind us, we are aware that this is a matter of concern. So what we are doing, at least I have not started anything at the university level, but I know that the school education department in Telangana, they are ensuring that some of the teachers are available. They have formed small groups on WhatsApp of teachers and some number of students. So the teacher acts as a counselor and is available beyond the class hours or school hours to guide students if they're having any difficulty. But I guess we need to have a fairly decentralized system of teacher counselors, etc., who can help the students in this way. And similarly, more online resources for them to seek help and advice and guidance in terms of their mental health as well.
Thank you very much, sir. I think we are on top of the hour. So unless there's anything else that somebody wants to really add, let me quickly summarize. I mean, we started with four towers, digital infrastructure, content, faculty, proctored assessment. I think we've touched upon all the four towers. I think the chair, the session chair, very nicely put it by saying that, look, it is not just for one or two universities. It has to be up. Whatever we decide, whatever we do, we have to keep in mind the 750, 800 odd universities across the country. And therefore, it has to be, it has to reach every one of them. And I think that's one important lesson. The other important lesson, of course, is that what we heard about, what Dr. Ajit said about the learner being taught how to learn, and that's the job of a university. We did talk about the faculty being an important element in disseminating the digitized content. And we did talk about the need for security and the need for the entire infrastructure to fall into place to kind of bring this entire digital transformation into play. As a last point, as an accelerator, I think it's also very important, and I'm glad that all of us are here on the panel. It's important for government, academia, and the university. All three of them should come together, because somewhere down the line, NEP 2020 has been set. And the government must also, the policies and the initiatives that they bring in must also tie up the academia and the universities. And I think together, the three of them can collaborate and make it a win-win for all the learners as well as for all of us. So thank you very much, everybody. Sir, thank you for being the session chair. And it was indeed a pleasure to know you and to hear you speak. I'm sure all of us have picked up a leaf from what you talked about, what Telangana is doing for infrastructure. And I'm sure your women entrepreneurship initiative for people to use the last mile cable and then convert, and how do you actually excite people seeing the YouTubes, and how do you excite them? I think that's a very good idea that we'll pick it up and we'll try and see how Fiki can work this through and take it to the other stage. So thank you very much, all my other esteemed panelists. Thanks a lot. It's been really enriching, and it's been a privilege to be a moderator of this panel. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ravi. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. No, the mouse part is missing.
How is it?
Okay. Yeah, it is okay.
We hit everything, no? It's on time. Not bad. I'm actually good in the sense. After a long time, I'm doing a panel. That's nice. Thanks, Rajesh.
Thank you.